tonight's starting lineups. First, for the visiting Blue Jays, a sophomore from White House Station, New Jersey, number 4, Brian Johansson. A sophomore from Brentwood, Tennessee, number 10, John Winley. A graduate from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, number 14, Tom Corey. A senior from Irvington, New York, number 15, Sydney Feinfeld. And a senior from Tucson, Arizona, number 21, Carson James. The Blue Jays are coached by Josh Leffler. He is assisted by Ricky Hernandez and Carl Lee. And now, the starters for your Swarthmore College tournament. A freshman from Sonora, California, number 12, Kyle Gibson. A junior from Aston, Pennsylvania, number 23, Gideon D'Angelo. A senior from Clark, New Jersey, number 24, George Visconti. A senior from Cincinnati, Ohio, number 33, Colin Shaw. And a junior from Lynchburg, Virginia, number 15, Michael Caprice. The Predator coach by Leonard Rosmalski. He's assisted by Shane Leffler, TJ Farrakhan, and Christian Matthews.
Welcome back in, everyone, to the Centennial Conference Digital Network for this heavyweight bout. Number 1 in the conference, Swarthmore. Number 2 in the conference, Johns Hopkins. Number 12 in the nation, Swarthmore. Number 11 in the nation, Johns Hopkins. Moments away from tipping off. Swarthmore 11-1, 5-0 in the conference on an 8-game winning streak, looking to push it to 9 tonight. Johns Hopkins 10-2. On the year, 4-1 in the conference. Only loss in conference was to Muhlenberg on December 3rd, 77-84. Starters out there waiting for the tip. Johns Hopkins in the mostly black and the light blue. Swarthmore in their traditional white and garnet. Tipped is won by Caprice and ends up right back in his hands. Player of the week, Centennial Conference Player of the Week, Vinny D'Angelo. Hands it off to Caprice. Shaw nearly slips there. Caprice, top of the key, looking. Hand off to Shaw. Shaw thought about it. 15 on the clock. Shaw steps back for three. What a start for the Garnet. First shot, first make, and it's from deep from Colin Shaw. Blue Jays going from right to left. Swarthmore in a man-to-man defense. Carson James driving in, fouled and one. So Shaw hits the three, then commits the foul on the other end. Got a whole lot of the wrist of Carson James as he finishes through the contact. I mentioned D'Angelo, named Centennial Conference Player of the Week, largely in part due to his showing in the 94-93 double OT win against Franklin and Marshall. Had 33 points, 11 rebounds, and 5 assists. Truly an incredible performance. Knotted up at 3 now after Carson James was good on his extra free throw. Caprice, not fond of the 3 ball, takes it in. Gonna post up, goes in, gives the shoulder. And a travel before he could get the shot off. So Sidney Thibault, the 6'8" senior out of Irvington, New York, read the scouting report. Caprice usually just stands out there just to give the ball off and kind of be a facilitator. James going to be the primary ball handler for most of this game. Almost always brings it up, and the offense runs through him. Kicks to the corner, sidesteps for three, too strong, rebound, Thibault, and hits it off of Caprice, will stay Johns Hopkins basketball. James to inbound out of the baseline. Inbound into Thibault, just barely past Caprice's outstretched arms. High screen set by him. Calling for it in the post. Doesn't get it. 10 on the shot clock. James with it out by the top of the key. Being hounded by D'Angelo. Gets away. Thibault gives a big shoulder to Capriz, and he draws the charge. So Swarthmore, after a lengthy defensive possession, gets the ball back. D'Angelo pulls up, high contested three, got fouled. Too strong on the attempt. Foul called on number 14, Tom Quarry. Quarry, the graduate student from Philadelphia, PA, attended Father Judge High School. Right around this area. So three shots at the line for the player of the week, Vinny D'Angelo. Hits the first. D'Angelo now at 17.1 points per game. That is good for third best in the Centennial Conference. Adding to his total, 2 points from the first two free throws, looking to go 3 for 3. D'Angelo also leads the conference in three-point percentage at 54.3%. Is doing wonders for his free throw percentage. Carson James commanding the offense even before he crosses half court. Uses the screen, has Thibault open, didn't see him, had his head down. Gets it away, guarded by Shaw. Thibault in that low post against Capriz. Two big bodies going at it. Thibault trying to power through, and Capriz with the stuff. Kicks it back out, 5 on the clock, driving in with the left hand, blocked by D'Angelo, moving the other way. Visconti has it, gets it across and slows down. Two blocks on that possession. One from Capriz, one from D'Angelo. Capriz right at the stripe, not even looking at the rim. And an offensive foul. Looks like they got D'Angelo with the elbow trying to cut through the defense. Eddie Paquette checking into the ballgame for Vinny D'Angelo, and then George Corzine in for Capriz. Capriz not in any foul trouble, but Coach Landry Kuzmalski likes to work his guys in often and early. James sets a screen, driving in with the left, spinning, kicks it back out. John Winley tried it there. James now tries. It goes in with the left hand. Nearly bounced in. Rebound by Hansen. Hansen gets it across. Visconti wanted it. Bit of a delay in getting the ball. Now has it way out. Gets it over to Corzine. Corzine over to Paquette. Corzine calls her back for a handoff to Paquette. Paquette nearly loses it. Luckily keeps possession. 10 on the shot clock. Working the perimeter. Haven't really tried to get it in. Visconti, 3 seconds. What a pass to Corzine. Hesitated. Goes up for the layup and gets it regardless. Had a wide open layup. Was a bit nervous about being blocked from behind, but still gets the two. Winley on that far side wing. Extra pass, top of the key. Spinning in. Carson James out by that corner. Shaw guarding it. Kicks out to Corey, ripped away by Visconti, and it will stay Johns Hopkins ball. So far, some fantastic defense by Swarthmore, and they've just been all over this Johns Hopkins offense. A few substitutions for either side for Swarthmore. TJ Chapman checks into the ballgame. Last time we were at the Tarpal Pavilion, he had his best game of the year. A few threes, a bunch of real nice layups driving in, highly contested layups as well, hoping to repeat that same performance. Was losing the ball for most of that time, but gets the friendly hook shot off the backboard. Will Sykes. Doesn't matter how it goes down, as long as it goes down. Shaw top of the key. Another two-man game between Shaw and Corzine. Shaw way off on that mid-range shoot. Chapman comes flying in and gets it. Calling for a travel, going to be a jump ball, and I believe Johns Hopkins will get possession. Head coach Josh Leffler of Johns Hopkins was calling for the travel there. Chapman ran in, grabbed it, and fell, but good no call in my mind. Leffler, a Swarthmore grad, graduated from Swarthmore College in 2003. So maybe a bit of a coming home party for me. Always nice to come back to your alma mater, even if you're coaching against them. Last year, Leffler and his squad beat Swarthmore in the Centennial Conference Championship later in the year, but lost to them twice in the regular season. TJ Chapman playing a bit too handsy, but maybe questionable call as number 10. John Winley was also using that offhand to try and create some separation. 15:26 left in this first half. Swarthmore still leading 8-5. You can feel the energy in the crowd. Large crowd tonight. They can tell. They know this is big time matchup. 11 versus 12 in the same conference as well. 1 versus 2. Whew. Doesn't get much better than this. Driving in with the right. Trying to work through. Throws it up off the glass. Rebound D'Angelo. Paquette driving in with the right off the glass. To no avail. Driving in and a blocking foul. Called on TJ Chapman. Couldn't get the feet set quick enough. His second foul. Two new substitutions for Johns Hopkins. Number 15, Sidney Thibault, back into the ballgame, as well as Brian Johansson. And Cal Hansen and Michael Capriz are back in for Chapman and Visconti. So you got Corzine, D'Angelo, Capriz, Paquette, and Hansen. Your five for the Garnet. Thibault keeps it, gets it away to Nixon. Nixon with the left, spinning through. Contested shot. Not sure if Capriz will get credited with a block there, but had a fantastic contest. D'Angelo drives in, adjusts with the right, short. Went up against three Johns Hopkins defenders. Up court pass to Quarry. Quarry crosses over, nearly loses it. Paquette stays with him. Nixon's three from the wing, rattles out. Floorboard Capriz. Michael Capriz, the leader in the Centennial Conference in rebounds per game. With 9.3, that is. Capriz pulls up from deep and hits it. I mentioned how Thibault read the scouting report. Maybe didn't read it thoroughly enough. If you leave a man out there for long enough that open, he's going to pull one eventually, and Capriz knocking it down. Now guarding Thibault the other end. Thibault getting in the low post, giving it up. Corey's deep three from the top of the key. It's a dead spot. And Capriz got shoved. I thought that was a clear push. It's going to be Johns Hopkins basketball, but it looks like Sidney Thibault got a clear extension of the arm in Capriz's back. I mean, there's no reason that Michael Capriz is going to be falling out of bounds while trying to save the ball otherwise, but let me reframe. Carson James to inbound. 11-5. Swarthmore leads. And an official's timeout. Going to need to clean it up after Capriz fell in that area. Make sure no one's slipping and sliding. Gets it in the Quarry. Quarry now guarded by Shaw. Capriz sticking on Thibault. James with it. Under 10 on the shot clock. Right back to Carson James. Carson James going in with the left-handed layup. Nearly tipped back in by Thibault. And almost saved, but right to Colin Shaw. Colin Shaw pushing the pace. Gets it over. D'Angelo thought about the three. Doesn't take it. Low post to Shaw. Capriz, another three. No. Short. Ooh, I thought Paquette saved it and hit it off of the foot of Johansson, but didn't have a clean look at it, so it will be Blue Jays ball yet again. Visconti checks back in for Paquette. So right back to the usual starting five for the Garnet. I mentioned how Landry Kosmalski, the head coach of Swarthmore, likes to work in a lot of guys. Tonight, the starters may get some extended minutes. Thought about the three. D'Angelo ends up on the floor, recovers quickly. Corner three, rims out, floorboard. A fight between Visconti and Hansen, and Hansen gets it. Hansen pushing the pace, going in with the left hand, swatted at the rim by Tom Quarry. The 6'1" Hansen challenging the 6'7" Quarry in height advantage. Entry pass, Thibel short, and a block! What a recovery from Michael Capriz! Driving in, Visconti short on that layup. Was looking for the contact. Doesn't get the call. Carson James, extra pass, open three. Rims out again. D'Angelo gets the tip rebound. Fast pace, moving offense for both ends. D'Angelo hesitates, tries to get his own rebound, off again on the layup. A lot of tough looks around the rim. And Quarry a bit banged up on the play. Under the basket, under Johns Hopkins' basket, I should say, kind of grabbing at his face. And a lot of players with the hands on the knees. It's been a fast-paced last few minutes for both sides. No real timeout, just a quick, maybe not injury timeout, but an injury check. So Quarry and Thibel will take a seat. Thibel not hurt. I imagine Quarry just taking a seat just to kind of collect his bearings. Johns Hopkins to get it out of the break. 11-5. Swarthmore leads. 11:56 left. Winley with it, guarded by Hansen. Looks for the screen. Uses it. Has a lane to the basket. Nearly a big swat. But enough of a good contest from Corzine to alter the shot. Paquette over to Hansen. Hansen. Corzine. He's been given space right around that elbow. Hasn't looked at the rim, though. Shaw, top of the key. Guarded by Johansson. A few ball fakes from Paquette. 6 seconds left. Three from the corner. Way off. Air ball from Hansen. Had to heave one. Swarthmore didn't get into their offense there. Had the small action between Corzine and Visconti, I believe it was. But other than that, just a lot of movement around the perimeter. Nothing really happening. James's shot is just off. Johns Hopkins has had a lot of clean looks, has been just a touch, just a hair off on most of them, it feels. Corzine open again from the mid-range, thinking about taking it. Going to take a few steps in, backing his man down, pump fake. Goes up with the right hand, too strong. Will Sykes did a good job staying disciplined there, not biting on the pump fake and reading exactly what George Corzine wanted to do. Hesitation with the left. Kicks it back out. Nixon driving in. Floats through the air. Short gets his own rebound and gets the two. Paquette gets it up quick. Shaw open for three. Hesitates. Drives in. Kicks it right back out. Paquette takes the contested three. Short. Rebound Johansson. James gets it to Sykes. Right back to Nixon. Nixon going with the right hand. Goes up with the right. Too strong. Ball on the ground. And just barely saved. What an effort from Brian Johansson. Carson James driving in on Paquette. Bit of a hesitation. Three from the top of the key. Hits back iron. Under 10 minutes. 11-7. Swarthmore, bit of a cold streak now. A leaving Corzine wide open in the corner. Visconti guarded by Jaden Nixon. Backdoor cut, Visconti, mid-range two, good. That's his bread and butter. Find him spotting up around the mid-range most of this game. Has a nice kind of one dribble pull up from the elbow. Beautiful looking shot. Corner three. Goes on top of the rim. Winley, he's had some open looks from the corner, just hasn't been able to cash in. Corzine thought about it again, spinning against Sykes. Another pump fake, right-handed post hook is up and in. Timeout called by Johns Hopkins. Back-to-back buckets. The Blue Jays thinking they need to talk some stuff over defensively. 15-7, Swarthmore leads. Going to take a short break. We'll be right back on the Centennial Conference Digital Network. Welcome back. Some early numbers, and I mentioned how Johns Hopkins has had some looks, but just hasn't cashed in. 3-for-22 from the field. 13% in this first half. Swarthmore only has 15 shots as well. Johns Hopkins, 6 offensive rebounds. Swarthmore, 0. It's almost the same story as the women's game prior to this. The Swarthmore women fell to the Johns Hopkins women's team, and they just couldn't get an offensive rebound. They couldn't stop Johns Hopkins from getting offensive rebounds as well. Swarthmore in the same boat. Luckily, as of now, Johns Hopkins shooting an abysmal 13% and 0-for-7 from 3. But there's a reason this team is 11th in the country. They will bounce back. So Swarthmore needs to take advantage of this shooting slump and start building on this lead. Up by 8. 11 seconds left. Nixon driving in with the right. Reverse layup fouled on the way up. Toby Thornburg, the culprit there, the freshman from Princeton, New Jersey. So Nixon heads to the line. His first attempts from the stripe. First one is through, 15-8. Low free throw numbers as well for either side. 3 apiece. Missing the second, 15-8. D'Angelo with it, pushing the pace. Sees Chapman. Chapman thought about stepping back for 3, didn't take it. D'Angelo swings it over to Shaw. Chapman can take a dribble. And it just looks like he's stranded out there. Thornburg not taking the 3. Caprice thinking about the mid-range 2. Will take it. And offline. Rebound Chapman. Chapman, deep 3 from D'Angelo. Just rims out. Tip back out. Good decision by T.J. Chapman. Instead of trying to save it, lets it go out. Read that tip very well. So Swarthmore will keep possession, checking in for the Blue Jays, Ben Ecke. He's in for John Winley. Winley 0-for-3 and 0-for-2 from three-point land. And a lot of them were open, makeable. Thornburg gets it over to Chapman. Chapman looking for Shaw, now looking for D'Angelo. Gets to D'Angelo, driving in mid-range and got tipped by Sidney Thibault. Quarry in transition, 3, rims out, rebound, Thibault knocked away. Great job by Colin Shaw, disrupting that rebound from Thibault. Kicks it back out, Thornburg, 3 too strong. Rebound Nixon. Looked like he was in rhythm. Thibault driving it on D'Angelo, missing the layup. D'Angelo crossing over, driving in, kicks it back out. Caprice, now Shaw. This Johns Hopkins team. Contrell rises up for the mid-range too. But I was going to mention, this Johns Hopkins team plays some great defense. Beat Haverford 75-45 in their last matchup. And nobody on that Haverford team scored above 8 points. But Swarthmore playing even better defense, out of bounds, will stay Johns Hopkins ball. Quarry missing the layup after drawing a lot of contact. Visconti, Hansen, Paquette, and Corzine back into the ballgame for Shaw. Chapman, Caprice, and Thornburg. But this Johns Hopkins team playing the best defense. I mean, not the best defense so far, but playing some fantastic defense. Only allowing 17 points so far and a lot of highly contested shots for Swarthmore. And Johns Hopkins just hasn't been able to convert on their offensive end. 17-8, 6:30 left. Nixon, three is good. A much-needed three. Their first one of the ball game for Jaden Nixon, 17-11. Back to a six-point lead. Screen from Corzine. Hansen rolling off of it. Kicks it back out. Five seconds left. Got to get something up quick. Gets off to Paquette. Open mid-range two off to the right. About as good of a look as you're going to get with 3 seconds left on the clock. James. Pass over to Nixon. Entry pass. Spinning on Corzine. Double teamed. Right back out to Nixon. Nixon pulls up the three from the same spot that he hit the first one. Missing this one. Corzine gets the rebound. D'Angelo over to Paquette. One more. Visconti's corner three. Too strong. 5:22. 17-11. Carson James brings it up. Double screen. Gets away from it. Quarry in the corner. Stepped out of bounds. Needs the spatial awareness. Low turnover numbers as well. Just been a very defensive game. I mean, both teams putting on a clinic. Two turnovers apiece. Johns Hopkins now at 14%. From the field, 1-for-10 from three. Swarthmore at 27% and 25 from three. Handoff and a bump trying to fight through the screen. Defensive foul called on John Winley. Swarthmore not in the bonus yet. Coach Kuzmalski calling out his baseline outage. Quarry will take a seat. No one in major foul trouble. Only one close is TJ Chapman with two. Quick entry pass and another foul called. Arms may have gotten locked up. This time called on Will Sykes. Carson James back in after the short rest. In for Ben Ecke. Same entry pass into D'Angelo. Was looking for Corzine again in the low post. Fading away layup offline. James guarded by Hansen. Sykes wants it in the low post and has all the room in the world to work with if he got it. Now in the high post. Gets over to Nixon. Nixon driving in with the right and one. D'Angelo commits the foul on Jaden Nixon, finishing through the contact, looking to make it a three-point deficit for Johns Hopkins. Nixon. Nixon with 8 points, looking to make it 9. And will. So 9 of his team's 14 points. And he's coming off the bench in this game, providing a spark to his Blue Jays squad. Paquette kicks it out to Capriz. Capriz over to Visconti. Visconti drives in, and an offensive foul called on Michael Capriz, the moving screen. Johns Hopkins has done just a great job. They know exactly. I mean, they know down to a T what Swarthmore wants to do. They want to work the high screen. They want to get the mid-range looks from right around each elbow, maybe inside each elbow. And they've really contained it. They've stopped the roller. I mean, they've done a great job defensively. Swarthmore as well, coming up with some major blocks, not letting Johns Hopkins get really any clean looks from inside that painted area. Kicks back out. A 3 from Nixon, short. He's feeling himself, and rightfully so. Under 4 minutes, Hansen brings it up over to Capriz. Got to work Capriz in that, right that mid to low post. Too much right around the three-point line. Now in the low post, spinning in on Thibault. Right-handed hook, short. Great defense from Thibault again. I mean, this has just been a battle in the low post between Corzine and Sykes and Capriz and Thibault. Another one and a foul called on Michael Capriz. Got too much of the arm on the way up against Sidney Thibault. Capriz's second foul of the ball game. Thibault off on the first free throw. Sidney Thibault, the 6'8", 245-pound senior out of Irvington, New York, as I said. And Capriz at 6'6". So Thibault has the 2-inch height advantage. And hits the second. 17-15, 2-point lead for Swarthmore, back on another cold streak. Haven't scored since the timeout from Johns Hopkins. Corzine mid-range 2, nearly rattled in. Offensive rebound, Paquette. Going to reset with a fresh 20 on the shot clock. 14 left. Shaw driving in, pump fake. Looking for anything. 5 on the clock. Has to throw something up. Short. Nixon a rebound. I mean, this Johns Hopkins team has just been very disciplined on the defensive end. Not jumping at any of the pump fakes. Just staying with your hands up. They have the height advantage on most of these matchups out there. Driving in. Corzine. Great defense. Leffler wants the foul call, doesn't get it, and that's a clear. Yeah, that felt like a clear push off by Eddie Paquette. Bit too much of the extended left elbow. And James, I believe it was Carson James, just flying backwards after it. So good job selling it, but still a clear offensive foul. Johns Hopkins looking to tie it up. James commanding his offense. Gets it over to Sykes, right back to James. James driving with the left, kicks it to Nixon. Nixon driving in. Can't get the layup, just pops out. Rebound, 50-50 ball knocked away and will stay. Johns Hopkins basketball. Capriz really doesn't like the call. I mean, Nixon has just been the key to this Blue Jays team. I mean, he's been shooting well. I mean, the pump fake and the quick first step. He's almost got a clear lane to the rim every single time. Corey's 3. Nearly rattled in. Rebound Sykes. Batted it down to himself. Knocked away. And will stay Johns Hopkins. 1:57 left in this first half. Will Sykes, 6'8", 240, 5 pounds less than Sidney Thibault. And Sykes is coming off the bench. James looking inbound, gets it into Nixon in the low post and gets the layup and one again. So Jaden Nixon with 11 points, 11 of their 17, looking to get 12. And I mean, that's just, you can't allow that off of an inbound. You have to block off the low post, the blocks. You can't let that easy of an entry pass get through. Paquette was on his back and really had no choice but the foul. So a bit of some confusion on who the foul was called on. It looked like that was a bit strange because they changed the call. It was initially a foul on Paquette, which was in the end the correct call. But they changed it to Colin Shaw, who was nowhere near Nixon. So, you know, all smoothed out in the end. And Jaden Nixon now with 12 points. 4-for-12 shooting, as well as 5 rebounds. Excuse me. Gives Johns Hopkins a lead. Hanson's corner three for the lead again, and he got it. Needed that bucket after a long cold streak for the Garnet. Back with a 2-point advantage, 20-18. Sykes hands it off. Now rolls to the basket. Winley's looking for Nixon. Nixon going to take it back out. Has Hanson on him. Likes the matchup. Bounce pass into Sykes. Can't finish the layup. Rebound Corzine and fouled by Will Sykes. Looks frustrated. Corzine, great job just ripping that rebound away from Sykes. Capri's getting animated on the sideline. Hyping up his teammates. Visconti to inbound to D'Angelo. Some pressure offered by Carson James. Nothing major, though. 1:13 left. Corzon gets the ball tipped away and will stay Garnet ball. John Winley came in and just got a hand in there, just enough to knock it away from Corzon and throw him off, make Swarthmore have to reset. D'Angelo right off the inbound. Ooh, that was a pretty one. Net barely needed to move on that make. And he kind of realized it's been tough to get some clean looks, so take it where you can get it. Thibault right back to Nixon, 22-18. Nixon driving in, drawing the contact, can't hit the layup. Good no call from the official. Nixon led with the body. 4-on-3. The corner for Visconti. Got it. Just a huge end to the half run for Swarthmore. Johns Hopkins going to get the last shot after rolling the ball up, chewing some of that play clock, shot clock unplugged. 25-18, Carson James with it. Visconti on his hip. Zone defense for Swarthmore. Winley over to James. James drives in, lane to the basket, reverse layup, doesn't get it. 3 seconds left, can get off a heave. 2 seconds, one. D'Angelo pulls up from three, pretty good look. Nearly got it off the back rim. Could have gave him a 10-point lead heading into the half. But 25-18, my goodness. From two teams who scored 30 in their last games in the first half, at least 30, only 25-18, not even 20 points for the 11th ranked team in the nation. That just shows you how great these defenses have played. I mean, every shot has been a tough look. We're going to take a short break for halftime. We'll return with second half action. You don't want to miss it. Stick around on the Centennial Conference Digital Network.
battle of really ugly basketball.
Very defensive. Johns Hopkins was 6 of 35.
Wow, Hopkins was 6 of 35 from the floor.
17%.
Wow, how about Swat?
Swarthmore is 9 for 30, 30%. Number 22, Jaden Nixon, 4 for 13 with 12 points.
He has 12?
So even though he had 12, still is 4 for 13.
Yeah. Yeah, but he had a bunch at the line, too, though, right?
Yeah, he had
a lot of and-one.
Yeah, 3 for 4 from the line.
Yeah. Who's John the top scorer?
John Hopkins is 1 for 12.
From 3? How about Swat?
Swat 4 from 3, 4 for 11. It's not bad.
And,
top scorer, you got 3 players with 5. D'Angelo, Visconti, and Shaw.
Wow. You know, last game on Saturday, Swarthmore beat F&M in double overtime, 94-93.
And they have 25 at the half.
Yeah, I know. I think it was, I was looking at the box, but I think they had like 35 in the first half or something. 25 now. I was watching some of the Johns Hopkins games their last year they played against Madison. They had 18, I think, with like 10 minutes left in the first half.
Very defensive. He doesn't go to Swarthmore. This is like a gig. You do other college games too?
I did Wyvern football in the fall.
All the home games?
Most of them.
Really?
Yeah. Like they switched halfway through, so I got like the last like four, I think. Even the first one I did color commentary. I'll do like semi-pro basketball, at least some high school
games. Semi-pro basketball? Who listens to that?
Nobody. But honestly, yeah, I get paid for it. It's not bad basketball.
What do you make? If you don't mind
about like $75 a game.
Uh-huh.
I do enough in a week.
Not bad. Are you going to try to do this when you get out?
This is something to radio. I've been doing a radio thing for the past 4 years.
Sports radio or? Yeah.
Had
right radio music.
Yeah. We're all commercial free. The reception's pretty short, but good station.
So do you take callers too?
Huh?
Do you take call-ins from your sports show or
what sometimes. Do you do? Every now and then. It's a college radio station, so I know.
So one of the I live here.
Oh. Okay.
And both of my kids went to Swarthmore. My son graduated in 2019. One of his friends growing up who ended up going to Episcopal and then he went to F&M. He was really into it. He like did minor league baseball in the summer. Went to Cape Cod, did it up there. So I mean, he interned at WIP. All that. You ever tried doing that?
Yeah, I'm part of a bunch of stuff. I got an interview for a SiriusXM station in D.C. like in a week. Should go well, I hope. The minor league baseball stuff, I know like that's where a lot of people start to kind of work their way up. It's just a long road.
Yeah, and you get paid. And
yeah,
you have
like
to ride the bus.
Is.
Yeah. Well, good luck.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it. Let's walk more close it out.
Thank you.
if you go on, like the Swarthmore Athletic site, and you go down to their schedule, and you say watch, and it'll take you to the Centennial Conference website, and that'll be the screen.
My daughter just texted her husband and said, you should move, we can be heard.
I knew it was.
Yeah. So I hope, I said a few critical things. I hope it's picked up.
All good.
Welcome back, everyone, to the Tarble Pavilion here in Swarthmore, Pennsylvania. Luke Nichols joining you, and my goodness, if you missed the first half, one of the best defensive halves, one of the best defensive 20-minute intervals I've ever seen in basketball. NBA, D1, high school, it doesn't matter. I mean, both sides were just absolutely perfect on defense. I mean, you're not going to pitch a shutout in a basketball game, but 25 to 18 for two teams who are up there in the conference for total points and averaging points. I mean, it was some impressive stuff. Low foul numbers as well for either side. Personal fouls, 10 for Swarthmore, only 5 for Johns Hopkins. Johns Hopkins 10-2, looking to improve to 11-2, and Swarthmore looking to add on to their 8-game win streak, and they'll start with the ball. Leading 25-18, D'Angelo over to Caprice. Ooh, passing that low block, double team, tries to get it back to Caprice, and just barely tips it out to Shaw, diving on the floor, love the hustle. Visconti thought about it, drives in, contested mid-range, can't fall, tipped back up in the air, and a foul on the floor. What a fight from Michael Caprice, doing all the dirty work in these first few seconds of action. Hanson off the inbound, got it. The second mid-range two of that kind of same play where right off the inbound, you just catch it, no dribble, pull right up for two. D'Angelo did it, now Hanson. Drop step short, rebound, knocked away, and will stay John Hopkins basketball. John Winley was a bit short there, and Thibault came flying in to disrupt it. Five off the inbound. James in the corner. James moving in, hesitating, throwing it back out. Dangerous pass from under the basket, the top of the key. Corey, the grad student, out of Father Judge. And ooh, a missed push off from Sidney Thibault on the putback. D'Angelo clearing out Hanson. Usual starting five out there for the Garnet. Caprice hands it off to Shaw. Mid-range two. Pull up. Too strong. Doesn't even get the rim. 27-20. Oh, both players kind of taking a hit there. Hansen and James bumping into each other. James was trying to fight around the screen. And Hansen gets a, they both kind of got hit in the face a bit. Hansen with a bloody eye now, I see. His right eye on the side of it, gushing some blood. James doesn't seem to be bleeding anywhere. Hansen will get treated. We'll have to take a seat as he gets patched up in the corner. TJ Chapman back in for him. So thought we were resuming play, just a quick conversation. Carson James still getting looked at as well now. Doesn't seem to be bleeding, but one of the athletic trainers wiping up a small bloody spot right around that right elbow. But I really can't trust enough the defense. I mean, Johns Hopkins is shooting 18%. It would be one thing if they were shooting maybe, you know, 26, 27%. Like, oh, wow, bad shooting game for them. 18%? That's just good defense. Even Swarthmore at 30%. A lot of shots for both sides have just been a struggle to find an open look. 30% to 18%, that's just a sign of just great defense being played. Even 1 for 12 from 3 for Johns Hopkins. Jaden Dixon, the leading scorer for this Blue Jays team, shooting 4 for 13, 3 for 4 from the stripe with 12 points. So although he's the leader, still poor percentage from the field. No one in double figures yet for Swarthmore, but 5 players with 5. James driving in, hesitating, fouled hard by Colin Shaw. No flagrant there. Some of the light blue shirts on the bench were kind of throwing their arms up saying, oh, looking for maybe a flagrant, but it was more one of those fouls where you knew you foul him and you want to get your money's worth for it. You want to ensure that he doesn't get that shot off. But the 5 players with 5 points for Swarthmore: Cal Hansen, Vinny D'Angelo, George Visconti, and Colin Shaw. Carson James' first free throw is through. Michael Capriz with 3 points, and George Corzine with 4. Two for two from the line as D'Angelo moves up. Capriz thought about the wing 3. Made one, missed one. That's a... Capriz thought he could get away with it. And... because Malski is having a conversation with the official, but maybe trying to say he never actually got set and then moved. He was just always kind of moving, trying to run through. But a clear moving screen there. Just tried to set the feet, just kept on shuffling. So that's going to be the 3rd on Michael Capriz. We'll have to take a seat as George Corzine checks back in. Ball on the floor. Shaw tried to dive for it. James kicks it back out. One more. Top of the key. Winley over to Corey. Corey with the left hand driving in. Pump fake. And wanted to travel. Not getting it. 5 seconds left. James working the mid-range. Dumps it off. What defense from Corzine to disrupt the layup attempt from Thibault. Chapman. One more. Visconti. Corner 3. Oh, thought he was going to get the shooter's roll. Carson James moving back up. Corey thought about the 3. He's quick to pull. There it is. Too strong again. Corey pulls a lot of 3s. D'Angelo layup just off Corzine's tip. Gets the rebound again. Fighting off 3 different Johns Hopkins defenders. And it will be Blue Jays possession. They're looking for a foul called on George Corzine. No change to call. It will be a foul. So number four, Brian Johansson, gets called for the foul. Not often do I see a deliberation between officials and even some barking from the bench that wants the foul call, and it actually goes in that bench's favor. So, see something new every day. D'Angelo working that baseline, flying in with the right-handed floater, just offline. So close on a lot of these attempts. So close. Winley at the wing, entry pass in the. That's Sykes trying a drop step on Corzine. Corzine standing his ground very well, I may add. Jaden Dixon had the hot hand in the first half. Gives it away. Right back to Sykes. Will Sykes to Dixon. Or Nixon, excuse me. Offline D'Angelo on offense. Corzine on the elbow. D'Angelo pops out for three. Offline, Paquette flies in for the rebound. No one got a body on him. Came in from the three-point line to snatch that. Chapman, top of the key, thinking about the three, doesn't take it. Another handoff. D'Angelo steps back, wide open. Off the back rim. Paquette, another offensive rebound, and throws it off of Nixon. Swarthmore keeps possession. Two offensive rebounds for Eddie Paquette, and both of them I'm counting as some hustle rebounds. Will Sykes checks out of the game. Sidney Thibault back in. Head coach Josh Leffler just kind of rotates his two bigs. D'Angelo with 10 seconds left. Corzine, top of the key, over to Chapman. Chapman has to go to work with 5 seconds. Four. Shaw. I don't realize how much time is left. Got to get a shot. Shot clock violation. Nobody was talking. Not even the bench was giving them a heads up about the shot clock. I mean, surprised. Very surprised no one gave the Swarthmore offense a heads up, especially after their third chance at a putback bucket. James drives in, loses control, didn't even get tipped. He just lost it on the way, flies out of bounds. So Swarthmore gifted another offensive possession after that shot clock violation. Jaden Nixon back into the game. John Winley back out. This Swarthmore team scored 94 points in the double overtime last game, now with just 27. With right around 15 minutes remaining in the game. Dump pass off to Corzine, right-handed layup. Just rolls the top of the rim and out. My goodness, the lid that is on this basket is sealed shut. Only 2 points for Swarthmore in this second half. Three from James, way short, air ball, but Corey, right place, right time, goes right back up and gets the two. I mean, it just fell right in Tom Corey's lap. Chapman got shoved out of bounds. Everybody wanting a call. Officials letting them play. D'Angelo taking his time. Going to use the screen from Corzine. Goes up with the right. Tip back out. Chapman over to Shaw. Chapman open for three. Pump fake. Lets his man fly by him. There's the three. Way too strong. Some of these shots are oh so close, and some of these shots looks like just the nerves are getting to some of these guys. Ball thrown away. That's going to be Swarthmore basketball. Yes, it is. Paquette and Chapman with the disruption. James falling on the floor and just smacks it out of bounds. Hanson, Paquette, Visconti, Shaw, and Corzine, your five. As Carson James takes a seat. Winley back in the game. Brian Johansson, Sidney Thibault, Tom Corey, and Jaden Nixon. The five for Johns Hopkins. Bit of a cleanup crew duty on the other end under the Swarthmore basket as we head towards Johns Hopkins basket as they play defense. Visconti with it. Right at the bottom left of the S. Visconti driving in, left-handed layup offline. And every single shot has been a high contest. Thibault gets it and fouled on the way up. Smart foul from Visconti. Sidney Thibault had a wide open look, wide open dunk possibly. Only Visconti's first as well. So Thibault heads to the line to shoot two. Thibault 1-for-2 from the stripe so far. And he's now 2-for-3. It's both. 27-26 with 13:50. No team has broken 30 points yet. I mean, this is just, what a game. What a game. D'Angelo going to his right, driving in, hesitating, gets his own rebound, triple team, gets it back out. Hansen's three from the top of the key is good. Cal Hansen, the scoring leader now for the Garnet. His second three of the ballgame. 8 points, 2-for-3 from beyond. Winley driving in with the left on Shaw. Double team now, kicks it back out. Open three from the wing. Off the back iron. House number 45, Colin Crothers. Some of his first minutes. Got a really clean look. Defense forgot about him. Corzine. Didn't look at the rim. Driving in. Shaw floater off the back rim. Tipped out. Will stay. SWAT basketball. I think I like SWAT better than I do Garnet. But Both are good. Visconti to inbound. 30-26. Up by 4. Gets it into D'Angelo. Immediate entry pass to Corzine. Backing his man down. Goes up. Doesn't get the foul. And missing the post hook. And a foul. In the backcourt. Loose ball foul called on George Corzine. Capriz heads back in after an extended rest, considering he has 3 personal fouls. Again, just some unbelievable defense, but Swarthmore with double the shot attempts of Johns Hopkins. But only shooting 12.5%. Johns Hopkins at 25%. And a complete flip of the offensive rebounding agenda. Swarthmore with 7. Johns Hopkins with 3. Swarthmore doing a much better job crashing the glass and just being more attentive on the glass. Tipped away, nearly a steal. Nixon controls it. Back out to Crothers. Crothers nearly got it taken away. Quarry looking to use the screen. 6 seconds. Thought about pulling up. Down the low post, Capriz playing tight defense. Fade away and just an ugly looking shot. Another great defensive possession. Johns Hopkins had nothing going for him there. Cross court pass, one more. Hansen, could it be his third? Yes, it can. Cal Hansen has the hot hand from deep. And the Blue Jays need a timeout. 33-26, Swarthmore. Finding some consistency on offense. We love to see it. Going to take a short break. 33-26. Swarthmore leading. back out of the timeout. And from my point of view, head coach Loeffler was giving his team an earful. Not happy with the effort in the defensive transition. Mostly just in transition, it looked like, whether it's offense or defense. 33-26, Swarthmore gaining some major momentum. James looking to inbound, just gets it into Johansson. Bible. James's three. Nearly tipped back in. Shaw saves it. They're looking for the out-of-bounds call, not going to get it. Paquette fouled in transition by Carson James. Not in the bonus yet, so we'll be a side out right next to their own bench. Hansen needs to step out of bounds. There he goes. It's Carson James' first foul of the game. Hand off to Hansen. Caprice, top of the key, gets it over to Shaw. James is denying Hansen the ball completely, and the second foul. Or excuse me, that's not James. That time it was called number four, Brian Johansson. Gonna reset, fresh 20 on the clock. Another side out. D'Angelo checking in for Paquette. D'Angelo clearing out. Going to get that screen from Caprice. Driving in with the right. Pump fake. Gets two on him. Gets the lefty reverse. Right over the hands of Thibault. 9-point lead for the Garnet. Thibault looking for Nixon. Nixon on the wing. Stolen by Hansen. Hansen gets on the floor. Knocked away. And we'll go back to the Blue Jays. Great hustle by Hansen to disrupt that, though, forcing Johns Hopkins to start from their own end. 15 on the shot clock. Paquette, a last-second substitution in for Visconti. Paquette will be tasked with guarding Jaden Nixon. Never mind, Shaw will take over duties. Paquette will guard James. Outside of the maybe 1 minute towards the end of the first half, Swarthmore has stayed in their man-to-man defense the entire ballgame. Screen from Thibault. D'Angelo fights over, gets off his feet, open three. Short. Actually a pretty good look for the minimal time they had to work. Paquette over to Caprice. Caprice thought about the in-transition three. Sets a screen for D'Angelo. D'Angelo uses it again. Kicks it out to Hansen. Caprice gave him a shoulder and right up with the post hook. The first double-digit lead of the game for either side, 37-26. Swarthmore leading. Winley stops, turns. Nixon crossover, runs into Winley. Poor spacing by the Blue Jays. Open three for Winley from the wing. Got it. It was only a matter of time before John Winley knocks down a three. Timeout called on the floor. Going to stay with you here. So this Swarthmore team, and you may say, Luke, you sound so surprised at the defense here. Honestly, I was expecting more of an offensive showing. Swarthmore, just Swarthmore alone. These are just the numbers among the conference. Second in points per game in the conference. Fourth in assists, second in rebounds, first in offensive efficiency, third in field goal percentage. Most of those, except for rebounds, rebounds are the exception because it's mostly defensive rebounds, but most of those are offensive numbers. D'Angelo, like I said, the best three-point shooter in the Centennial Conference, third in the conference in points per game. Visconti not far behind, 14.2 points per game, ninth in the conference. This team, they knock them down. They're a good team. They're a good shooting team. But the defenses have been on display. in the starlight. Got to appreciate a good defensive battle every once in a while. Swarthmore to start with, a D'Angelo being picked up by James in the backcourt. Guarded by Corey, trying to blow right by him. Gets a right-handed layup short. Caprice tips it out. Shaw nearly got it back. Three-on-three break. Winley just hit the three. 37-29 now. Through the hands and maybe a push. And it will be. Bit of a shove in the back called on Michael Caprice against Sidney Thibault. So Caprice will check back out now with four personal fouls. Can't risk losing him still with 9 minutes left to go. Passing to Nixon, going with the left. Missing the layup, tipped back by Sykes. Couldn't get it and fouled on the floor by Corzine. D'Angelo fell, may have either slipped or because of the bit of an extension by Nixon. Doesn't matter now, because Sykes got the rebound and is headed back to the line for two. Or headed to the line for the first time tonight, I should say, for two. Will Sykes, first free throw. Too strong. Oh, it was a one-and-one. Thought they got him on the shot. So, Johns Hopkins in the bonus for the remainder of the game. Chapman, mid-range two, fading away. Got it. And those kind of shots have been the best ones for Swarthmore. The highest efficiency looks. You don't take a dribble. You just catch it off a pass. Wow, what a finish by Carson James. Paquette, a lot of contact, no foul call. But just kind of catching it right off a pass and going right up. Wow, Corzine just barely saved it. D'Angelo right back over to Corzine. Great defense. Carson James going from behind. Just barely gets it away. Chapman entry pass. Ooh, nearly knocked over the camera. Great catch by whoever's working the camera down there to save it. But 7 seconds left will be a baseline out. SWAT, they can't get too complacent too early. Felt like D'Angelo was kind of trying to dribble out some of the clock there. Maybe just didn't have anything that he liked, but felt like he was going a bit slow. It's only an 8-point lead and fouled right on the inbound by John Winley. Bit too aggressive going for the steal, trying to fight back in it, and reached right around Vinny D'Angelo for the foul. So five total fouls in this second half now for the Blue Jays. D'Angelo gets it off the inbound. Pump fakes once, now rises for two. Too strong, rebound Winley. Too long of a rebound for Corzine to corral. James ignores the screen from Thibault, now somewhat uses it. Nearly a steal, Paquette just couldn't hang on to it. Hit off his hand and out of bounds. 8:06 left, 39-31. Swarthmore, the 8-point advantage. Inbound to Thibault. Looking for that cross-court pass to Corey. One extra to Corey. There's the three from the corner. Short rebound, Chapman. Oh, man. Chapman flying in coast to coast, getting the layup. Oh, my goodness. T.J. Chapman, do it yourself, young fella. Going back the other way, and a layup. The other end by John Winley, but T.J. Chapman, man. The speed just up court, the strides, the perfect lay. Thing of beauty. Corzine, top of the key, 41-33. Right back out to Visconti. Visconti, right back to Corzine. Right-handed hook. Almost got his own rebound. Thibault may have gotten a hand on it. Corey open for three. D'Angelo caught sleeping, and Corey makes him pay. 41-36. 7 minutes left. Some extracurriculars being provided after the timeout call. Let's get back into the box score real quick. D'Angelo has gone cold in the second half. 2-for-16 shooting, only with 7 points, 0-for-4 from three. He's got to get it going. George Visconti, only 7 attempts, 5 points. 0-for-3 for Eddie Paquette. TJ Chapman, 2-for-3. The mid-range in that layup. I mean, going coast-to-coast after getting the rebound. Love it. Just doing it all yourself. You don't need to get into the offense every single time. If you feel that momentum, if you feel you can make a good shot for yourself, why not go and take it? As for Johns Hopkins, Tom Corey, it was only a matter of time. 0-for-5 from 3. He's too good of a shooter to not make one. 1-for-6, and that time just caught D'Angelo slipping. Just the off-ball movement, so important. You see Klay Thompson, you see Steph Curry, you see some of these great shooters. Even Seth Curry, the off-ball movement is such an essential part of the game. It goes unnoticed for these three-point shooters. Team numbers in this second half. 29% for Swarthmore, 33% from the field for Johns Hopkins. Even on rebounds, 15 each. Swarthmore with an offensive rebounding advantage, but Johns Hopkins with the defensive rebounding advantage. Swarthmore hangs on, or is hanging on, to a 5-point lead, 41-36. As they exit the huddle, 6:59 left. Truly, just a fantastic game. Just a fantastic game so far. Again, if you're wondering to yourself, is this bad offense or is it good defense? Good defense is disrespectful to call this game. Just a massive understatement. D'Angelo driving in, over to, gets the layup, does Corzine. Goes up with the right hand, no hesitation this time. Great look from D'Angelo, just penetrating and kicking. 43-36. Low post. Carson James, that hesitation there paid off. Goes up with the right hand. Corzine has no intentions of pulling that. Hanson driving in. Ooh, had an open look, but Corzine gets fouled on the pass by Sidney Thibault. Chuck Thibault's fouls. Only his second personal foul. Only one in foul trouble for the Blue Jays is Brian Johansson with 3. Capriz in foul trouble with 4. Swarthmore with 17 total personal fouls in the ball game. Johns Hopkins with just 11. D'Angelo being patient along that wing with James covering him. Stopping, fading away for 2. Oh, man, he just so close on so many looks. That one just barely popping out again. Ten seconds on the clock. Thought about the 3. Johansson driving in, losing it, getting it back. 3 from Nixon in the corner. Short tipped away. Visconti with it. Rips it away from Thibault. Corzine, open lane, bumped. Doesn't go up for the shot, but fouled nevertheless. Now into the bonus goes the Garnet. 1-1 chance for George Corzine. 2 new substitutions for Johns Hopkins. Number 44, Will Sykes back in, and number 14, Tom Corey after a short rest. Thibault takes a seat, as does Nixon. I imagine they will also be on short rest. First free throw off, but a rebound for Visconti. Right back up, no foul call. And gets his own rebound again. Jump ball will be in favor of Johns Hopkins. Visconti had a clean look. Just couldn't find a home at the bottom of the bucket. Toby Thornburg looks to check in for Corzine. Toby Thornburg, the 6'6" freshman. Now guarding Sykes, James driving with the right, spinning, fade away. Wow, the friendly roll falls 43-40 with under 5 minutes. Big time bucket. D'Angelo drives in, bounce pass into Thornburg. Thornburg drop step, looking for a layup. No foul call, and very short on that attempt. Maybe had an open look, just didn't get enough under it. Corey, three, short rebound. Johansson, right back out to Corey. One more to James. James. Winley's wing, three. Another rebound on the floor. D'Angelo comes up with it, thought Sykes had it. D'Angelo driving in with the left, over to Hansen. Hansen finds himself open, takes another three. Man, Cal Hansen with his fourth three of the ball game, and they need a timeout yet again. 46-40 with 4:08. How did they let him get that open? It looks like that Cal Hansen was covered at first. And then the seas just parted. Just opened up for him, a wide open look. Yet again, the leader for this Garnet squad, shooting 4-for-5 from deep, 5-for-7 from the field. He's feeling it tonight, 14 total points. The leading scorer for the game as well. Carson James starting to come along with 11 points. And Nixon has been stuck at 12 since that first half. 46-40. Is the score. 4:08 left. Hansen will stay in the game. Looks like the regular five now for the Garnet. Hansen, D'Angelo, Visconti, Caprice, and Shaw. Shaw started off the game with the three, the first bucket of the game for either side, and only has 2 points since then. James over to Thibault. It's been a lot of this James and Thibault pick and roll. Caprice guards it well. May have gotten a block. And, oh, I think Caprice gets the foul, and he is fouled out. Never mind, it was on Colin Shaw. Thought they got Caprice, but it was just a whole mess in that restricted area. So the foul called to number 35, Colin Shaw. That'll send number 4, Brian Johansson, to the line for a 1-1. Johansson actually the leading rebounder tonight. As we have some deliberation, maybe a discussion if it was on Caprice. Josh Leffler, head coach for Johns Hopkins, was trying to influence the refs just like Coach Kosmalski did. Called on Caprice. First free throw is off. Floorboard to D'Angelo. So although D'Angelo hasn't been scoring well, he's been everywhere else, getting rebounds, controlling the tempo very well. Caprice looking for a shot. Left-hand post hook just off the back rim. Nearly got his own rebound. Saved by Winley. 3:35, 46-40. Carson James works off that screen. Tries to shrug off Visconti. Kicks it back out. Thought about the three. Over to Nixon. Driving in, wide open look for Sidney Thibault, all thanks to the wraparound bounce pass from Carson James. Landry Kuzmowski just orchestrating the offense himself, standing right there, all eyes on him. Screen from Capriz, driving in, D'Angelo kicks it back out. Hansen thought about the three, driving in with the left, mid-range two. Man, he's on fire. He is just on fire in the most important moments tonight. Hansen has showed up. 6 for 8 from the field, 16 total points for Cal Hansen. Carson James driving in, kicks it out. Deep three. Off to the left. Shaw. Visconti, top of the key. Hands it off to Capriz. Visconti, mid-range two. High arcing mid-range two. Long floorboard to James. Carson James, and we lost it again. Nixon. And Carson James going to take over. Call the executive timeout. Wants his team to reset. 48-42, 2:11 left. Going to take a short break. We'll be right back on the Centennial Conference Digital Network. Back after the break, and notice the trend for this Swarthmore team. The last three buckets they've had have all come right around after 2 minutes of not getting anything. 6:34, Corzine with a layup. 4:13, Hansen with a three, and then 2:53, Hansen with a mid-range two. Need to be more consistent in these last 2:11, or at least play even more shutdown defense than you've already been playing. 48-42, Carson James driving in. Wide open layup for Winley. Ooh, Visconti may have gotten a hand on that. Regardless, great contest again, under 2 minutes. 48-42, Visconti with it. Entry pass into Shaw, finds a wide open layup. The fumble on the catch actually made the difference. Allowed a slight hesitation for Shaw. Driving in and answering immediately is Carson James in a quick timeout on the floor, 50-44. 1:41 left. Capriz with four fouls. If he's going to check back in, it feels like now is the time for Capriz to be back in the ballgame. Some numbers here. D'Angelo with 8 rebounds, leader on the team. Hansen still leading the SWAT team in points, 16. George Visconti, who won Player of the Week, Centennial Conference Player of the Week, that is, back on December 13th, the second Swarthmore player, or I guess the first to win it this year, and D'Angelo won it this past week. Hopefully, the rest of the way, maybe everybody gets a turn. But outside of Hansen with 16, no one else in double figures. D'Angelo with 7, Visconti with 5, Colin Shaw with 7, Michael Capriz with 5, TJ Chapman with 4, George Corzine with 6. Full court press from Johns Hopkins. Get in D'Angelo, they trap right off the catch. Capriz looking to get it across, takes one dribble, picks it right back up. Visconti gets it across. Got a bit nervous there once Capriz took the one dribble and stopped. Shaw drives in on the baseline, flies in the reverse left, nearly went in, tip in from Capriz, no good, and fouled. on the tip-in. Sidney Thibel fouled on the shot. Two shots coming up for Michael Capriz. Very, and I mean very low free throw numbers for Swarthmore. Only their fifth and sixth attempts coming up for Capriz. Johns Hopkins with 13 attempts, making 9 of them. Capriz ready at the line with all eyes on him. First one good. 51-44. 7-point advantage. Looking to get it back up to 8. The Blue Jays are going to be moving quick after this shot. And 2 for 2 after not taking a free throw all game. Michael Capriz, perfect from the line. Can't ask for much more from your big man. 52-44. Letting it roll. Saving some time. Picking it up now. Winley hands it off. James right back to Winley. Winley had the open three. Drives in with the left hand. Gets the layup. Great patience and another timeout called by head coach Leffler of Johns Hopkins. Going to take a short break. 52-46. We'll be right back. Both teams moving slow out of their huddles. And Swarthmore to start with it. Visconti to inbound. The other four, D'Angelo, Hansen, Capriz, and Shaw. Looking. Gets it to Hansen. Hansen double teamed. Has to get it away. Needs to start moving. Got to pass through the press. Gets it up to Shaw. Wow. Whew. Close on there. Ooh. Nearly a foul or a travel there. Hansen, double team, gets it away to Capriz. Capriz looking, under a minute now. Visconti taking their time, 10 seconds left on the shot clock, 50 on the game clock. Using the screen from Capriz, driving in, kicking it out. Hansen's three. Short, just out. Rebound, Johansson. Carson James looking, open for three, pulls it. Short, rebound Capriz, fouled in the backcourt by Sidney Thibel. Will walk the floor for a 1-1 for Michael Capriz. And Sidney Thibel with his fifth foul is done for the night. Has to take a seat. Will Sykes back into the game. And I mentioned earlier how Sidney Thibel 6'8", 245. Will Sykes 6'8", 240. So, you know, not too upset if you're Johns Hopkins. Caprice free throw off to the left. James with it. Carson James moving up. Shot clock still in play. Nixon on the wing. Gets it over. Sykes open. Doesn't take it. Wendley looking. Scanning. James drives in with the right. Dumps it off. Back out. Wendley open three. Pump fakes. Contested three from the top of the key. Rims out. Rebound Shaw. Shaw ripped and just ragdolled by Sykes, but it doesn't matter. This crowd is starting to get a sense. This game may be over. Another, well now, two shots, double bonus for the SWAT and Colin Shaw. Gets the first. 53-46, the Garnet lead. Krizine will check in if he makes it. Does not. Off the back rim. James up court pass to Quarry. Quarry looking to pull it. Will from the wing. Off the side of the rim. Shaw another rebound. 5 seconds left. And that's all she wrote. Number 12, the Swarthmore Garnet take down. Number 11, Johns Hopkins Blue Jays. Just a massive win on the season, keeping the winning streak alive, moving to 12-2, 9-game winning streak for the SWAT. Just an unbelievable defensive game. Cal Hansen making big shot after big shot. Overall, both teams just played astronomically well. 53-46, your final score. Thank you for joining us for this top 25 matchup between 12 and 11. Swarthmore, the victor. For Luke Nichols, again, thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time, and have a great night.